I just wanted to say one thing very briefly about Demián Bichir and about A Better Life. His range as an actor is truly extraordinary. His artistry, the integrity, the immediacy, and the real dramatic intensity of his roles is very, very impressive. Natalie Portman, when she nominated Demián Bichir for the Best Actor Oscar, put it very beautifully when she said, in A Better Life, he has given voice to the voiceless. He has caused us to empathize with those who are part of this experience. I think that's very moving and very true. Something else occurred to me. Certainly, you have made us see the humanity of an undocumented gardener and his son in LA, and all those who shared that experience. But your portrayal and the way you presented this character was so powerful that, speaking for myself, I suspect for many of you, you make us recognize our own humanity as well. Because our own humanity is found in the way we react to that condition and what it makes us think, feel, and act. So with that, we were thinking of beginning an informal conversation and then having the questions and comments of everyone here.
Thank you. Well, first of all, muchas gracias por estar aquí. Thanks so much for joining us here today. I said yes right away when Beatriz called me and invited me over, because there's no way you can say no to Beatriz.
Right? I'd have to say I would agree with that.
Yeah. You've been saying yes for how many years? And to this historic place, and I've been walking through the campus, you know, just now, and it's just an honor and a privilege to be here, as I'm sure it is for you to be, you know, a part of the history of this place. You put it very well, because this is not only a story of immigration or of an undocumented worker. This is about a father and a son, and the love of a father for his son, and that's universal. And it's been interesting to see the many different reactions throughout the every place where we have shown the film, how people react to it. And basically, everyone is very moved by the story of how anybody, in this case, this man, overcomes any obstacle to give his son a better life. I think the most powerful thing about all this is that you have this Mexican macho turn into the best mother ever. that was very appealing for anybody. And then and it's funny that you show the Fidel clip from Steven Soderbergh's tape, because when I play Fidel, I gain 30 some pounds, and then it took me a year to lose that weight. And then I met Chris White, and he told me, wow, when I saw Fidel, when I saw you in Che, I thought this guy would be perfect to play this gardener. And then it hit me, because, you see, sometimes, I'm sure there are some actors or artists here, filmmakers, musicians, you know how hard this is, you know, it's brutal. The competition out there is brutal. There's so much talent everywhere. And whenever you go into an audition, most casting directors want to see you being the character right there, because they see so many people every day. You know, they see 300 people like you or better than you. And so if you are close to the character, then, you know, everything helps. Very few casting directors actually have the imagination of seeing you with a different face. So the fact that Chris Weitz thought that I could be perfect to play such different characters, I was, you know, God bless his heart, because that's what you want as an actor, you know. Some people don't even direct you. Some people don't even, you know, give you any directions. They just, you just read through the scene, and they sometimes they stop you through, you know, halfway through, and they say, thank you, that's all we need. Goodbye. John Collins, we call you. And then when he said, you know, you'd be perfect to play these characters, total different people from going from this guy who's bigger than life and wants to make sure that you listen when he talks, all the way to this character who prefers to transit almost in an invisible way in order to survive. So that was right there a big challenge. And then, but then he told me, you know, I think Carlos Galindo should be heavier than you. And I said, oh, no, please, man, it took me a year to get rid of that. I said, no, really, we should really put some weight on that. I said, oh, yeah, well, okay. So I began putting some weight on, and I remember I was in Mexico working on something else, and I was packing up, you know, pigging out. And then he would send me these emails all the time. How's the weight going? How's the weight going? So one day, one morning, I just took a picture of my belly. You know, like that. And I sent it over here, and he replied, stop! Hold it right there. And that was only part of the preparation for the role. And then it took me another year to lose it. Don't do this, kids at home. I'm a professional, all right? Don't try that at home. And then everything else regarding how to keep it... to keep your life in a low profile kind of way, almost like a saint. And I remember buying this truck from a fellow countryman that I saw at a red light. I rolled down the window of my car and I said, hey, paisano, do you sell your truck? And he said, no, man, this is what I work with. I said, well, how much would you, you know, sell it for if you sold it, right? He said, well, so-and-so, and then we closed the deal that night. And that was, I was driving that beat-up truck, really, really bad truck for, I don't know, 3-5 months or so. And it was really interesting to see how everything changes and how life changes when you dress differently or you don't have, you know, the car that people think would make you successful or, you know. And then I realized that that this thing about discrimination, it's more social than anything else. Sometimes if you're not, you know, with a perfect haircut and a fantastic clothing and all that, they see you differently. And of course, all my paisanos, my fellow countrymen, they have, it's a double, triple, difficult task to survive in this country because, first of all, you don't have a face, you don't have a name, you don't exist, basically. And they don't want you to exist. So everyone benefits from this force, this tremendous labor force, force of labor. Everyone benefits from them, but not themselves. And Mexico, they have a fantastic, you know, income through all these 12 million undocumented workers every year, sending all this money all the way to Mexico. So that's fine. Why should I give, you know, the people of Mexico a decent education, a better future, a better life right here in this country, if they can go somewhere else, make a living, and then send money? And then, you know, on this side of the border also, you know, this is perfect because these guys don't have, you know, the proper documentation to become a union kind of labor. They can't go on a strike. They will work for $4, $6, $8, $10, if you're lucky. So everyone takes advantage of that. And then politicians, right? Everyone keeps telling everyone that, this is the new enemy. So there's no more Osama. Now this is the new enemy. These guys are taking our jobs. These guys are, you know, taking advantage of every single little thing that we have. And the truth of the matter is that the lack of information and the terrible way that the media works, lying constantly, make everyone think that, yes, these people are, you know, some kind of devil or demon or something. And for example, what happened in Alabama, one of the toughest implemented laws regarding immigration or undocumented workers, is that after they told everyone, if you look Mexican, we will stop you and ask for your papers, and if you're not, you know, legal, we will send you back home. First of all, there's no home anywhere else but here. Your home is where you have your bed, and if you're studying over here, that's your home. You know, your new bed, your new side bed table, everything, all your toys, even sexual toys. everything that you have there, that's who you are, right? And your kids, that's where you belong, right? So there's no way they can send you back anywhere because that's your home. And so what happened in Alabama, for example, is that almost the morning after the law was implemented, it was like a ghost town because all my paisanos, they don't know how stubborn we are. I mean, we have walked distances. We cross borders. We cross rivers. We cross deserts. And there's no wall high enough that's going to stop immigration. This is about something else. And so no one in Alabama, not a single American, let's call it a white legal American, show their faces in the on the fields to claim those jobs. Not a single one. So the fruit rotten the fields. No one was there to pack meat. And it was a total lie. And then all these people who were supporting that law, they went to Congress and said, please, change the law again, because everything is, you know, fucked up here. We need this labor. We need these people. And so I want to think that whenever you do a film, I believe in the power of cinema. I believe that 2 hours can change the way people think and can probably move you to become something greater in life. And can bring new ideas and change many things. And we took the film to the White House last year, 1.5 years ago, and then to the Capitol building. And we were talking to some politicians. And our goal, our main dream was to make this film, you know, reach a large audience if we were lucky. And then, you know, this is only a small little part of what it is. But we want to think that if anything's going to change, even this little film, even those little 2 hours can help to change many, many other things. And it's just, you know, for me as an actor, there's very little thing that I can, you know, things that I can do to change things other than, you know, probably go into writing and write those stories. That can inspire people, you know, hopefully after this talk that we will have, some of you will think that, you know, anything is possible. I'm a good example of that, you know. I learned English when I was already an adult, like 22, 23 or something like that. And I moved to New York after growing up in the theater in Mexico and all that. I always wanted to give myself another chance to expand. And I remember getting to New York and thinking that I knew something to survive. And all I knew was the pencil is red and the window is open. and good afternoon and good luck, you know? And it was crazy because it was like another planet, not only another language. And then, you know, everything was against my own odds. It took me a while to find an agent because after 40, no one wants any newcomer. Because whatever I did in Mexico, no one cares. You know, they just don't, it doesn't count. You have to start from scratch. So after Che, is when Che happened, that things began, you know, to open. So, and that's pretty much what I always tell anyone, you know, when I talk to, you know, some kids or some other good friends or in any, under any circumstances, that it is true that anything is possible, that you can do whatever you want, you know, and I always believe that you have that power, the power of changing. And this is an incredible place, you know, where all that happened many years back. So if you feel like asking anything before going into any Q&A, I'll be happy to answer.
Fantastic. Professor Motz, do you?
Is this on? It should be on. Can you hear me? No, it's not.
It's on.
It's what? Now it's on. Now? No.
It's on now? Can you hear me? Yeah? No.
No, it's on.
It's green.
It's on.
It's on?
Can you hear me now?
No. Voice is powerful. So.
My voice is powerful, so. No, really? It's not. It's.
Does that one work?
No, not either. Okay. Can you hear me in the back? No? No.
Yeah?
Yeah? Okay. More than a question, I wanted to make a comment. You said that a better life is such a human story. It's not just about immigration, but you did an amazing role of acting.
Thank you.
Amazing. And it reminded me when I contacted Chris Weitz to come. I saw the film.
He's the director.
He's the director of the film. When I went with three colleagues to see the film here on Shattuck without knowing much about it. And I tell you, at the end, literally, I was paralyzed, crying. Mm-hmm. I just, finally, my colleagues were sitting there politely and they said, they're coming to sweep the popcorn. We have got to leave. And I'm like this. I mean, it was so familiar to me and so painful. And then, so I contacted Chris Weitz in Hollywood, and luckily he decided to come and show the film, and we had a conversation like this. And I told him a month or so later, well, this was a very easy job for you as a director, because, no, I told him that before he came. I said, because I wasn't quite familiar with your role here in the United States, so I said, this was a very easy job for you to direct, because clearly the only thing you did was go here to Hearst and 4th Street and follow a gardener, because no one in the planet can act like that. Simply, I mean, the way you walked, you gained weight. I mean, it was so perfect. I said, he just followed a gardener. I mean, you cannot act like that. So a few months later, he sent me an email and he said, guess what? He has been nominated for an Oscar. I mean, obviously. I mean, that was an incredible performance.
Thank
so that's
you
all
much.
I wanted to say.
Thank you. Hopefully you can take a look at it. We lost the first round of the box office. And that was a very bad news back then, because the way Hollywood works is about numbers. So even if our film is a fantastic piece of work, piece of art, no one really cares about that but the numbers. So the message here is pretty clear. You know, Hollywood would not make many films like this because it did not do good at the box office. However, a lot of people are watching the film after it came out on a DVD. So many people bought it. Some people just jump into Netflix or iTunes to rent it. And many, many people talk to me about it. So if you have a chance to take a look at it and then spread the word, then, you know, it will be worth making the effort and all that, because these type of films have to be made in order to change the course of the future.
I have a problem. If we look at A Better Life, how did you change as a result of the film?
I already knew many things about, you know, not only the gardeners who work in Los Angeles, but also the nannies and the cooks and the valet parking guys and the bus boys. And I have a lot of friends that I, you know, interact with every day. And that's the thing that a lot of people don't really pay attention to. Most of my Anglo friends, they told me, I never really noticed the gardeners in Los Angeles until I saw the film. And it is true, because it's what happens, like when you see a beggar in the streets, when you see someone asking for money in a, you know, light in a corner or something, you just close the door and then you just don't want to see because it hurts. And but they are everywhere. And there isn't a single activity in our lives in the United States where an undocumented worker is not involved every day. And they cook our food, they park our cars, they take care of our babies, and many, many other things. So for me, I already knew that part. But the most interesting part of all this was to listen to everyone's story, because I went in a, on a, when I, while I was gaining weight, I was also learning the craft of gardening and stopping looking for these trucks everywhere in, you know, in some neighborhoods. And I would stop and talk to them, and they were always very generous to share their stories with me. And I was taking all that into my own character in order to be able to portray that. So for me, it was crucial in the sense of acquiring a new responsibility. This was not only about being happy as an actor portraying this role or being a part of this film, but also I was part of that voice. And I became part of that voice, and every time I can, I've been using it. That is probably the biggest change regarding that specific film, you know. And every time I can, I talk about it. And of course, you know, many things change when you get an Oscar nomination or the SAG Award nomination, or the Independent Film nomination. A lot of things change. You know, you get more better projects directly to your hands. And I think the biggest change after Che, for example, is that I used to get in line with those 300 fellow peers. And then sometimes, you know, they just call you straight and say, we want to meet you. And then instead of an audition, it's a breakfast meeting or a lunch meeting, or they just, you know, welcome you and say, thank you for being here. I like your work very much. I actually met Chris Weitz auditioning for New Moon. Chris Weitz, for those of who you don't know who Chris Weitz is, he directed A Bottle Boy, he directed New Moon, the second vampire saga movies, and The Golden Compass. And so after he was auditioning for New Moon, and there was this Italian vampire that they needed at the end of the film, and then he called me to audition for that. So when I got there, he said, oh, thank you very much for coming. And this is the thing, you know, and it's a very, very important project that we're, you know, preparing. So it's about this gardener who's an undocumented, and he has his son, and he works very hard to give his son a better life. And so I got a little bit confused because I didn't know if he was a vampire gardener. So I was, sleeping at night, like upside down in the, and they're hanging from the palm trees or something, you know, right? And that was pretty much that, you know. I learned how to climb up. That's me. When you see that, that's one of the tallest palm trees I've ever seen in my life. and he asked me, I remember, how do you feel about going up? I said, going up the ladder, going up in my career, going up. Like going up where? Going up the palm tree. I was like, ooh, nice, yeah. I'm all actors are crazy. We always say yes. That's why I learned to horseback ride, because they call me and they say, do you ride? Yeah, bicycle? No, do you horseback ride? I said, well, I was born on a horse. Of course. Oh, perfect, because I need you to be an expert. Perfect. So I hanged up and I went to learn how to... It was this place in Mexico, and there was this kid who had some horses. He rented those horses on Sundays, and I went all the way there to look for him, and I said, I need to learn how to horseback ride in 10 days. I said, oh, cabrón, bueno. Oh, cabrón. I've been riding for 20 years, man. I still fall. You know? I fall off the horse all the time. You know? I said, so is that a no? No. Let's try. And then that's how I learned. And that's pretty much how I know everything in my life. They pay me to know more about life. I'm always very excited about doing my own stunts. But then, of course, I told him, yeah, I'm pleased, bring it on, yeah, let's go up. I said, okay, take it easy. I first need to clear you with insurance and all that, and so we'll see. And then I did it, and it was kind of crazy. It was really, really great, because...
How many times did you go up?
That we shot that in one day. During the course of 12 hours, I went up and down for 9 times, maybe. Yeah.
And the palm tree.
Yes, and it is a beautiful view once we're up there. But you know the tricky part? This was like a really thick, wide palm tree, and still it moves a lot. So what you can't tell, but when it's there, it's like, ooh. It's like, it's a really, really great, fantastic feeling. And I do all kinds of crazy things, but it's all part of the job.
We are going to open it up to any questions or comments that you have. Yes.
Hola, Demián. Gusto en conocerte. So as a Mexican actor, where do you think Hollywood and society is in terms of Latino actors in Hollywood? Like you said, it's really important to tell the powerful stories like A Better Life about the Mexicans and the Mexican-American experience, because most people cannot relate to the struggle we face, and films like these offer a glimpse into the lives of Latinos in the U.S. But then there's also the problem of Latinos being typecasted in roles tied to these very problems or stereotypes based on our ethnicity. Do you think it's time to begin assimilating to Hollywood and ignoring our color? Or do you think more films like these need to be made before we can ignore color?
Hollywood works in a very peculiar way. They call it show business. I call it a form, an art form. I prefer to see this as a way of creating art. And everything that happens in Hollywood has to do with numbers. And that's pretty much how you see, you know, fantastic careers going nowhere or just disappearing from one day to another because they don't meet the numbers. They don't become successes in box office, right? They don't become box office successes or they just don't meet the expectations that everyone has over them. Everything has to do with numbers. We're doing a series now called The Bridge. And we just did the first season, and they ordered a second season. And so we're all very excited about it, because we think we have a quality kind of a show in our hands. But no one cares about that only if you don't do the numbers, if you don't meet the expectations. This is about that. Even if we created the most impressive piece of art, if no one sees us, then that is that. You only get one season. So yes, we need to tell many different stories about us. But the most important part is yours. You have to pay a ticket and go see it and spread the word and tell everyone. Because if you don't do that, that's the easiest way for Hollywood to say, perfect, they don't care for it, let's not do another story like that. So we can make, you know, as many films like this as we can. Many films have been made like this in Latin America, not only in Mexico. But to have this exposure, to be able to show it over here and probably get a nomination and get that attention. It's funny because when we were talking about the Natalie Portman's presentation, when she talked about the character and the ceremony, that was part of my speech. I had a speech, yeah. That was part of the speech that I had prepared, part of what she said. So I was very happy at the end because, and I told her later on, I told her, listen, thanks for saying that because that was for me what mattered, you know, that in front of billions of spectators, you could pass the word and talk about how important it is to give these people a face and a name and a voice. So she said it more beautifully and elegantly, so that was cool, that was covered. But We made a lot of films in all the way from Mexico, all the way down to Argentina, that no one can see over here. That they don't get a nomination, they don't get the attention, they don't get, you know, not even a theater release anywhere. So in order to have that exposure, you need to first make a good film, and then, you know, once it's out there, spread the word as soon as possible so everyone can see it and send the message to anybody, whoever wants to invest $10 million in a film, they would think, you know what I want? I want to make a story about an undocumented worker and about a Mexican lawyer who became a lawyer after being, you know, undocumented, or, you know, to make the film about Alfredo Quiñones Hinojosa, one of the best neurosurgeons in the United States who crossed the border with no papers, no money, and no English, and became a fantastic neurosurgeon. Right? We want to tell that story. We want to tell those stories about, you know, so many lawyers and so many, probably some politicians also. You know, maybe the story of, I don't know, sportsmen also, you know, sports stars. But when we do that, you have to tell your friends, let's go and see it. Otherwise, no one will care.
Yes.
Hola, Demián.
Hola.
I know you have been acting all your life, and I'd like to know what inspired you to become a director, and if you can talk about a little bit about your new movie.
Well, that's another thing that I...
Is this the new movie that's being premiered here at Berkeley?
Yeah. Harley already invited me to present it over here, and I will be delighted to bring it over. It's a film that it's a story that I wrote a few years back, and that I directed, and and we just finished shooting that in New Orleans. The story happens in Mexico and New Orleans, and there's another way, you know, of being able to tell more stories. Hopefully, you know, we can keep on doing it and bring better stories than that to the screen. So what moved me to do that is pretty much that I'm very nosy, and I always want to be involved of the whole project in every film or anything. And sometimes they can listen to you, but your word would not be the last. So directing is about making decisions and you know, having the last word on everything. It's a big responsibility, but it's something that I enjoy very much. And it was a fantastic experience for me. And I hope we can, you know, put it together. We're in that process now, we finished. So now we have to edit it and then work on the music and the sound mixing and the final release and all that. So hopefully, if you see it somewhere, so hopefully you can go and you know, see it and spread the word, maybe. Some films don't need that. You know, some films have tremendous potential in publicity that can, you know, everyone knows about that film, and then you don't need to tell your friends to go see it. But this film is the story of a small little boy who grows up in a circus and becomes a man throughout the search of true love, and then destiny and fate play a key role in, you know, when the protagonist saves his life by his own father without knowing each other. And so it's a romantic drama that hopefully, you know, will have a good life out there in theaters. And after that, you know, we have many different projects line up that we want to work on.
That's the one called Refugio?
This is the one called Refugio. Refugio is the name of the main character. And Refugio in Mexico is a name that you can apply to men or women. And I just met one refugio out here, just walking through the campus, from Mexico, of course. And refugio means refuge also. So it's a different meaning kind of word.
Hola, Damien. Le tengo una pregunta. You do an amazing job at the Bridge. I just wanted to know what you've learned from playing Marcos Ruiz, police in Juarez.
So many Mexicans here. That's great, Mexican power, orale! yeah, the Bridge, wow. You know, many things are accurate about the show, and I'm still struggling and fighting every day to make it even better. I have a fantastic crew of producers, writers, and directors, and we always exchange a good deal of ideas and thoughts about this and that. So we hope that this second season is going to be even better. This is a character that I enjoy playing very much because it has this duality that we all have. You know, this is a man who has some flaws, and he can be a fantastic human being, but he also, you know, he can fail too. This is a character who transits constantly between both sides of the border, from El Paso, Texas, to Ciudad Juarez. It's a fantastic setup because El Paso has been voted like one of the most secure cities in the United States, and then against Ciudad Juarez, only a few yards away, one of the most dangerous places on earth. But so we talk about that in general. We talk about corruption on both sides of the border, which is something that I think is very, very interesting in the show. We talk about this co-responsibility on how you have to deal with the same border being so different. So this is a character who can talk with an angel and a demon in the same day and be able to walk on fire and never get burned by it. So you need some talents to do that. And this is a cop that is an honest cop. This guy believes that he can create a difference, he can make a difference, you know, even though the panorama, the geography, and the place is difficult. That's what I think is appealing about this character. And then the character that Diane Kruger plays, Sonia Cross, that's the perfect analogy of how Mexico and the United States work, because we're so different, and still we need to be together. You know, we're there. We're destined to be together forever and ever. So we better learn to, you know, like each other. And not only that, but recognizing our own similarities and differences so we can work together to solve the problems that we share.
Here. Right here.
Otro Mexicano?
No. He's a Mexicano in training.
It's a pleasure to have a chance to ask a question.
Well, pleasure, man.
Demián, I had a chance to see you act in Nadando con Tiburones in Teatro Insurgentes.
You saw that?
I did.
That's incredible.
This is a play where Demián Bichir played the most evil cutthroat TV executive, movie executive, I believe.
That's incredible.
You can imagine, you seem to have a lot of fun playing that role.
Yeah.
But one thing I noticed was when you came out on stage for the first time, the audience gave you this huge ovation. And I thought to myself, he must feel an awful lot of pressure representing so many Mexicans. This was right after you'd been nominated for Best
Actor.
And I thought you must be feeling an awful lot of pressure that so many Mexicans know who you are now and think of you representing them in another country.
That's interesting.
And in Hollywood. How did that make you feel, receiving that kind of ovation?
First of all, thank you for, you know, I'm glad you saw that. This is the story of that play. This is a play based on a film that is out there. You can see it. It's a classic. It's a cult film almost. That Kevin Spacey was playing the character that I play in the play. It's called Swimming with Sharks. So they did the film and then they adapted the whole thing into a theater play, and it was done in London first, and then in Mexico. I co-produced the whole thing with some good friends in Mexico. I translated the whole thing into Spanish, and my brother, my younger brother, directed it. And it was funny because we planned to do that play for 4 years, and we could not find the time to do it, because you need some at least 6 months to commit to that, you know, rehearsals and preparation and this and that, and then the run. So we finally set up a time, and I told my producer, my co-producer, I told him, listen, you know, we should do it, you know, we should begin right now, because I have the feeling that I'm going to be busier. So yeah, let's just begin with that. And we opened the same week they announced the nomination. We couldn't have planned it better. I mean, if we sat down and tried to plan that, you know, crazy plan, it wouldn't have worked. So it was crazy. People have always been very, very nice with me and my family throughout the years, because we've been around for a long, long, long time, ever since we were kids. But it was very funny the way it worked. Everywhere I went, the thing that people told me many times, pretty much everywhere I will go, is that thank you for this good news, because we needed some good news. Things haven't been good in Mexico for a long time. And then I remember there was this restaurant that is huge, it's fantastic food, right across the theater. We were only, you know, ready to open. It was Tuesday, we would open on Thursday, and they announced the nomination the morning of the Tuesday. And then we went to have lunch, as we pretty much did every day, and the place was packed. And then, you know, sometimes you just enter a place and you say hi to people, they say hi to you, some pictures here and there, photos here and there, or an autograph here and there, and that was that, you know. But when I entered the restaurant at this time, there was an ovation of everyone, you know. The whole restaurant were like very, very emotional about it. And then during the run of the play, every night that would happen. And then at the end, before I went to the ceremony, they would shout things like, you know, I felt like I was a bullfighter or something, you know what I mean? They would shout like a standing ovation, shouting, yeah, Demián, go for it. Go get that little sucker. At the time, you know, bring that statue back home. Things like that. You know, it was really, really weird. But it was like a festive kind of feeling in the air, you know. It was very interesting. And then we did 126 shows. And you saw one of them, so thank you very much.
Hi, good afternoon. I'll give some context to my question. So I believe that one of the biggest dividers in our community for the Chicano Latino community is basically that a lot of the folks who do obtain access to these powerful industries, such as the media industry, become so caught up with the glamour and the glitz and the fame with it, and that comes along with it. And so essentially, the way you've portrayed yourself today, you know, you're very grounded, you're very humble. And so my question to you is, what kept you committed, you know, to your roots, to your community, and what kept you humble throughout all this access to, like, this industry?
Well, I think I've been around for too long. Ever since I was a kid, you know, for me, this is like the only life that I know. I grew up with my parents doing it and just going around everywhere. I think if you really believe that that's it and you are it, then you lose everything. No matter who you are, you know, a Nobel Prize, a fantastic writer, a fantastic musician, or a great teacher, or, you know, this is, I mean, as long as we both have the same two eyes, one mouth, two legs, you know, we're pretty much the same. And for me, that's all that matters. Every time I have an invitation to go to a place like this, I say yes immediately. And it's a big challenge to accommodate dates and stuff and things like that because of, you know, sometimes time is not your best friend. But if I had a chance to talk to every single person who stops you on the street and then know their stories, that's what enriches me more. Everyone has a story to tell. Everyone has a beautiful, you know, thing or two to teach you. And that's, to me, what life is about. You know, the rest is only, I don't have a good time in red carpets or, you know, interviews and, or that's a part of the business that I don't enjoy very much. You know, I do it because it's part of my job, and I don't have any problems doing it either. But it's not something, I'm not a party animal, for example, or anything like that, you know. So I remember one day I was shooting in Spain a film, and they called from a magazine in Mexico, oh, can we follow your steps in Spain and go through a day in the life of Demián and this and that? I said, you're going to get bored to death. Because I'm not what you think I am. You know, I go back to my hotel, I read, I study, I waste my time in many other different ways, you know. And it's not glamorous as you think, you know. I think maybe one of the things that Brad Pitt misses most, is just be able to go out and see life. Be able to enter a restaurant, a museum, you know, the subway in Rome or in Paris or New York and not being watched, looked at. You know, Daniel Day-Lewis quit acting for a while because he said, I love watching life, observing life, and then I became the observed. the point of observation. So instead of me being able to look, I was looked at. And that's something that I enjoy very much. You know, I can go anywhere and enjoy that. So, and I hope, you know, it can stay there for, like that, for a good time.
Hello. Going off the previous question on the use of such issues like undocumented workers in the U.S., I want to know your thoughts on comparison between two films. You were in like A Better Life, this high dramatic drama based on the focus of an undocumented worker, and then your work in, forgive me for being lowbrow, Machete Kills, which uses the same theme, but now it's in this ridiculous blockbuster action format, and I want to know your the differences you think of using the approach, using this theme in two different formats. One that's obviously going to be looked as, oh, this Oscar movie, and another one that's like, oh, look, blood on the screen.
It's a, you see, this is about many different things. First of all, I'm an actor. And I love to experiment. I embrace the chance of being able to go from one genre to another. I wish I could make every film a political film. That's impossible. There's not an audience for that. This is, for me, art is about the people who are involved in it. And sometimes I say yes only because of the names involved. Robert Rodriguez is one of those guys. Robert Rodriguez is a fantastic example of how, you know, you can create whatever you want in your head or any kind of a new fantasy world. And that's what I do for a living. I tell stories. I fantasize. I die many times. I have died so many times in my life, in so many different ways. You know? And just the fact that you are able to do that. And that, I was talking about Chris Weitz a little, you know, while ago. He can make A Better Life, you know, all the time. You know, there are many different stories and many different genres and many different ways of approaching the work. I think that entertaining, having a couple of hours that can give you some time off your crazy life, your chaotic life sometimes, That's also good. I try to go into different ways as much as I can. It's funny because speaking of political films, I've done many, even though it's not out there. You know, like every script is, it's not what you would love to do. You know, I'm not that lucky. Most of the political films, sometimes they don't come to you. And even if you fight for them, they don't want you. But I've done films about the massacre in Tlatelolco in Mexico, right where, you know, everything was happening here also, 1968. It's called Rojo Amanecer. I did another political film about the M19 group who took the embassy in Bogota and held hostage 61 ambassadors. It's based on true events. I play Fidel Castro also. I just did another film about the father of Mexican independence called Hidalgo, the story never told before. And I hope to, you know, to be able to do that a little more. But if tomorrow Martin Scorsese calls me and sends me a crazy script, I'm going to say yes automatically. As I said before, this is about the names. And sometimes are the names who make me say no, also. You know, I say, no, thank you. So this is pretty much what, you know, an actor's life is all about. And I was talking a little before that the best way of having more control over that is creating your own projects. So hopefully in the future we will be able to do that too.
No, yes.
Hi there. I'm a European, but my dad was born in Mexico.
Your dad is from Mexico?
Yeah, he was born in Monterrey.
Oh, that's Monterrey.
Uh-huh.
Nice.
Grew up in DF.
That's incredible. You see, that's another thing, because speaking of stereotypes and cliches and all that, it's really hard to, I mean, whenever you tell anyone, you know, that you can cast a blonde, blue-eyed person to play Mexican, they go like, what? That's impossible. It's really hard to break those molds, you know, and but it's life, it's real. And still, you know, you see that all the time. Not only with Mexicans, with African Americans, with Asian friends, and with many other ethnicities. And also, whenever you portray an American person in an English, in a Mexican film, that has to be blonde, you know what I mean? So it's all the way, you know, back and forth. I'm sorry, what were you saying?
A dumb blonde at that. I was just curious, is there any one particular film that you wish was able to garner a greater audience, or any one particular story that you're hoping to tell in the future that you haven't yet gotten to say?
Yeah, I still think, you know, I'm very happy that I keep hearing more and more and more about A Better Life. A Better Life is an important film. It's a very important film that needs to be watched. Also, you know, there are many other films that never saw in the United States. No one saw in the United States that, you know, probably would have been nice to bring over here. There's one called American Visa. It's the story of a father who's an English teacher who's trying to get a visa in Bolivia in order to see his son who lives in Miami. And it's crazy. He can't get it. There are many, many different stories that I like to tell and talk about. As I was saying before, you know, about fantastic doctors, lawyers, athletes, many different stories that we need to tell, you know, and hopefully when we do that, people will go and pay a ticket to see him.
This will be the last one, and I'm going to also make some very brief concluding remarks.
Good afternoon. So you've been involved in film, television, and theater, and all three are very different mediums. In fact, you know, acting for the camera is so different than acting on the stage, and especially on the stage, you get such an immediate response from the audience. You can really tell if the audience is enjoying what you're doing by the atmosphere in the room. So for you, what has been the most enjoyable medium to work in?
It's all about the project. It's all about the actual essence of the project. You know, I feel comfortable in the three medias. I've been done some dubbing for some films, I feel great. I grew up doing theater, so I will always feel the urge to go back on the stage and do it again and again and again. And then I think there's something fascinating about films that keeps, you know, bringing everything, good and bad, for me, for myself. A lot of people say that we love films because there's a sense of eternity. But some people say we love theater because we can't see ourselves. We can't see what we're doing. We're so critical, you know. Whenever you see yourself on the screen, it's like, ooh. You don't like anything about yourself, you know. You have to learn to like yourself, you know, and the way you talk and the way your voice sounds and everything, you know. Like, I think it's about the project, you know. Whatever fantastic story, names, you know, artists involved or great character, that's where I want to be. Yeah.
Yes, one very quick one.
Hi, thank you for all your thoughts. I just wanted to give one last closing question. We're all here at the University of California, Berkeley, which is one of the best public, the best public university in the United States, if not the world. And this class draws a lot of Latino youth and Latino students who have managed to enter Berkeley's doors and in a sense try to fight for that better life that your film is talking about. However, the underside of UC Berkeley that UC Berkeley doesn't like to talk about is that these states, these same Latino students, when they go out into the world, they're still discriminated against. Mm-hmm. And UC Berkeley also has hundreds and hundreds of undocumented undergraduate students who are allowed to pursue a degree here, but when they leave this privileged space, they're still undocumented immigrants with a UC Berkeley degree. And so I was wondering if you had any words of advice for all the young Latino students in this room, some of which are probably undocumented, about how to sort of move forward with their life, if you have some last words of advice for them.
There's a big deal of things that I can learn from that community of people. Instead of me giving any advice, I always take their courage and how powerful their minds and determination are, because there's no obstacle they cannot overcome, you know, and that's pretty much how the Latin blood is all about. Not only Mexicans, you know, we're tough, and we're tough to beat, because life is not fair, and but you can see, you know, stories over and over again that of people overcoming any kind of obstacles. You know, I think the key message here is to Congress and the and President Obama and everyone against an immigration reform to stop playing games and just face reality. This, all these 12 undocumented workers are here to stay. They're not going anywhere, and they're part of the force of this nation. And they make this country better. They make our lives easier, happier, and that needs to be faced. And so I would only tell them, you know, this is one of those social struggles throughout the history of this country that is gonna be won. It will be conquered.
I wanted. I just wanted to briefly thank Demián for being with us today. His character as an artist across the wide range of such different things he starred in, whether on the stage, whether on film, whether in television, I think is truly exceptional. There is an intensity, an integrity, a passion, and an understanding of the human condition in a film like A Better Life, but as the mayor of Tijuana in Weeds, as Marco Ruiz in The Bridge, and in a whole range of other things that you've starred in as an artist, as an actor. You've led us to that better understanding. It's truly been an honor and a privilege for us to have you in Berkeley.
Thank you.
And we look forward to continuing the conversation.
Thank you very much. Thank you, guys.